Okay, welcome everybody to the to this session of the Probabilidad, Seminario Probabilidades de Chile. We have the pleasure to have with us Rafael Boutez. Rafael is now a postdoc in Université de Genève. He did his PhD about random polynomial with Jalil Shafai. So he's going to talk to us about the universality of the outliers in weakly confined Coulomb systems. Thank you, Rafael.
So thank you, Abelio. So it's my great pleasure to talk here, even though I would rather do this in live. It was the occasion to visit Chile. So, okay, my goal is to tell you about outliers for weakly confined Coulomb systems. So the talk will be mostly about Coulomb gases, and there will be a little part of random polynomials because I always put some random polynomials in my talks. So let me first define what is a Coulomb gas, at least in dimension two. So it's a system of particles in interaction where you have n electrons with charge minus one who are under the effect of an electrical field, which I will write kappa nv. Okay, kappa n is a scaling factor, which will be like n or n plus one, something like that. So if you have two electrons, so at location x1 and x2, which are seen as complex numbers because we are in dimension two, each one of them gets its own energy given by the electrical field. And the system also, there is also the repulsion between electrons, which is given by the energy of the repulsion is given by minus logarithm of the distance, which is okay. Let's take this for granted, is given by the physics. So for two electrons, we can combine all the energies and we get the total energy of the red plus the blue terms. For n electrons, you can immediately generalize. So you sum all the pairs. So the term in red will give you the pairwise interaction energy. And the term in blue will give you the sum of the energy of each electron. So the term kappa n is mandatory here. Okay. You really want the V to scale with the number of electrons. So the two terms can be balanced. The red sum is a double sum. There is around n square terms. So you want the right sum, the blue sum, to be also of the same order so the two terms can compete. So in this talk, kappa n will be any sequence which is between n and n plus one. But okay, you can only think about it at n or n plus one. So a Coulomb gas, so now that we describe the energy of the system, a Coulomb gas is what? It's a random vector with a joint distribution given by exponential minus beta times the energy that we described just before. To make it to probability density, you need to divide by a normalizing constant, which is just the integral of the exponential. So for me, a Coulomb gas with n particle has several parameters. There is a potential V that we need to choose. It's a function. And a parameter beta. Beta is interpreted as the inverse of a temperature. Because when beta is extremely large, so the temperature is extremely low, your exponential is very concentrated close to the minimum of the energy. In terms of statistical physics, this energy term that I wrote before is called the Hamiltonian of the system. And so we are dealing with the canonical model associated to the Hamiltonian. If you are familiar with Andromache matrix theory, you can take advantage of the fact that the exponential of log is the identity. And you can rewrite this joint distribution in the form of a product of the xi minus xj to the power beta times the exponential. So if you're doing random matrix theory, you recognize the van der Waals determinant and it rings a bell. Well, okay, I defined the most general Coulomb gas model in dimension two, which is what I just gave. Now, I want to define a specific subclass of model, which I call the Jellium. So this is, I say I call the Jellium, not everybody calls it the Jellium because it's a model that has been recently introduced, reintroduced because there are some old instances of the model. So it's not super standard. The Jellium is what? The Jellium is just taking a specific V. And I take V of the form integral of log of z minus w with a modulus integrated with respect to a measure nu. So this is the logarithmic potential of a measure nu. So okay, this is like my Coulomb is just taking v being a logarithmic potential of a probability measure. It models a very simple situation. So before we had an electrical field giving an energy to each of the electrons, now we know where it comes from. We have a fixed background of charges given by, okay, choose kappa nu, I wrote n plus one nu. So this is a continuous distribution of charges, positive, with total charge n plus one. You have n electrons of charge minus one, which are attracted by this positive distribution of charge because they are of opposite charge. And the system is nearly neutral because the difference of positive and negative charge is small, it's one. Okay. One last thing, I emphasize the fact that the positive distribution of charge nu is fixed, is given by the problem. So only the electrons can move. The thing you may want to do is to take a total charge for nu equal to n. Like having a system which is charge neutral looks better. There is an issue with this choice, which is, if I go back one slide, this probability distribution needs to be well defined. And if you take kappa n equals n in my choice of Jellium, unfortunately, you cannot define a probability measure as the integral is plus infinity, so you cannot have a normalizing constant. So if you want this function to be integrable and to be able to divide by something to make it a probability density, you need kappa n to be strictly greater than n. So think of kappa n as n plus one or n plus something. So
Rafael,
two simulations. Yes, she has a question. Don't hesitate to stop me.
Yeah, so why is that condition there?
Kappa n strictly greater than n.
Yeah, I mean, because you say that, how do I see? I mean, is it easy to see that you need that?
If you want to see v nu is equivalent to log at infinity. So really, like when you are very far, like if nu is supported on the compact, very far away from the compact, v nu of z is really like log z. So if you look at what you have in the exponential, you have just look at one variable, xk, like x1. So you have in x1, you have this n log x1. If you look at what happens on for x1 in the red term, you will get n minus one log x1. Okay. And so just the variable x1, you can integrate.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I see it now.
So, but if you are strictly greater than n, then the power in front of x1 is enough to have something integral.
Yeah.
So it's one of the limitations of the model because people usually would like to have kappa n equal n to consider really a charge neutral Jellium. So two simulations. On the left, I took the background uniform on the unit disk, and I simulated, I think there are like around 500 points. And you see that, without surprise, the electrons are attracted by the positive background and they fit the positive charges. And you also see some electrons outside of the support. Second simulation, new uniform on the unit circle, same amount of particles. Okay, no big surprise, they are attracted by the circle and you still see some particles outside. Okay. Just let me tell one word about the model of random polynomials that's interesting. So it will be very short, but at the end of the talk, I will say something about it. So one very, very interesting model, this is like my favorite model of all probability models, is random polynomials. So you fix an inner product, and this inner product has a very specific shape. Like it's an L2 inner product with a weight, exponential minus 2n v nu, and you integrate with respect to the measure nu. So the same v nu as in the previous slide, the logarithmic potential of the measure nu. This inner product gives you orthonormal basis. I call it RKN. Okay, it depends on K and N because the inner product depends on N. So when you change N to N plus one, potentially you change all your polynomials. And you look at the random polynomial Pn of z, which is just the polynomial with Gaussian IID coefficients in the basis Rkn. So a random combination of this basis. And what you are interested in is the zeros of this guy. And okay, for rather deep reasons, there is a very interesting connection between zeros of this guy and the JLM model associated to the same nu. And it was there. And it has many connections with geometric things introduced by Zetunie and Zeldich. So just to pique your interest, these two images are not the same as the previous ones. These two images are simulations of the zeros of random polynomials associated with nu uniform on the disk and uniform on the circle. So next slide compares, okay, on top, the two pictures that you saw for the JLM, below, the two pictures for zeros of random polynomials. And I think it's very, okay, except the fact that I didn't use the same software to draw these pictures, it's very hard to distinguish them. Like to say, oh, this is a random polynomial and this is a JLM, it's very hard. Like, it's doable because there is very tiny differences, but in distribution, it's very, look. Okay. So one result which is already known in the literature for a long time is, okay, maybe I should go back to the fact that the particles cluster on nu. Like if I look, so, okay, on the simulation is probably kind of obvious. If you look at the JLM associated to a background nu, whatever the temperature is, you can look at the empirical measure of the system. It's just 1 over n, the sum of Dirac masses at the particles. So the ZK can be ever, okay, this is the ZK are the electrons. Then this random probability measure, because okay, 1 over n sum of n direct mass is the probability measure. So this is a random probability measure, which goes, as n goes to infinity, towards the measure nu. And this is absolutely not surprising as, the positive background attracts the electrons. So that's fine. And there is a big history around this result, with even large deviations principle. I think I wrote also the rate function for large deviations, many, many things around this convergence are known. Another interesting thing, which is much more subtle, not much more subtle, but I think much more recent at least, is the fact that for zeros of random polynomials, the same result is true. So on the previous picture, you saw it. When you take uniform on the disk, your particles go uniformly on the disk. When you take new uniform on the circle, your particles go uniformly on the circle. And this has been a large deviation. I've been working on this during my PhD a lot. And okay. So at the level of empirical measures, this convergence is well understood, and this is not my plan to explain it today. But okay, let me go back one more time on these pictures. So now that we take for granted the convergence of empirical measures, there are a couple of questions which can arise when you look at these pictures closely. So go back to my questions. First, are there particles, so either electrons or zeros of random polynomials, outside of the support? So do outliers exist? Because the convergence of empirical measures allows some outliers. The only thing that it tells you is that the proportion of particles outside of the support of nu must go to zero. So it's little o of n. But you could have square root n or even n, any power of n smaller than one could exist of number of outliers. So how many outliers can we see for finite n? But okay, this is being able to describe how many outliers there are for finite n is not the thing that interests me the most. The thing which interests me the most is to describe the outliers as a point process. So is there a limit? So if I just look at the particles outside the support of nu, does it converge to some limiting object? And if it converges, does it depend on V? Does it depend on other properties? On V, on nu? And also in the random polynomial case, okay, something, I define the random polynomials with complex Gaussian coefficients, but you could define them for real Gaussian coefficients, for Poisson coefficients, for whatever coefficient you like. You would have an interesting model for non-coefficients. Does it really depend on the AK? Okay, so Now I will need to I need to introduce in order to be able to present a little bit the proof and the theorems, I need to present something which is very classical for Coulomb gases, which is a determinantal structure for beta equals 2. So remember, there was a parameter beta, which was the inverse of a temperature. And there is something extremely particular that appears, that happens when beta equals to 2. The point process given by the Coulomb gas, so really like the random vector seen as a point process, becomes a determinantal point process associated to a kernel which is explicit. So I will, for those who don't know what is a determinantal point process, I will define it just after, so no worries. Just saying that there is an explicit kernel, Kn, we have the formula written just here. Kn is a sum of orthogonal polynomials times the weight, exponential type kappa n v of z plus v of w. Actually, yeah, there is a mistake here. There should be a bar, but okay. So if you take an orthonormal system in L2 with this weight, you get a kernel. And one thing which will be extremely important is that in general for determinant type on processes, the kernel is never unique. So I will define what it is just after. But remember that, okay, this formula I could add, and like the statement of the theorem would be always true. If I add any purely imaginary function to V, then it's also an admissible kernel for the same point process. So now, okay, probably you should have determinant? Yes.
One question. So the potential may be imaginary. So this I haven't.
Yeah. No. At start, the potential is a real function. I'm just saying, if I want, I can give it a complex phase.
Yeah, because when you put the bar over the V with W.
Yes, I forgot the bar.
Yeah, but.
No. I didn't forget the bar. Sorry. Yes.
Okay.
If V is complex, I should put a bar. But if V is not complex, then I'm fine. Like if V is real, this is true. But wait, what I meant here is, okay, I have my V nu, which is naturally real, like it's a logarithmic potential of a measure, but I can add to this guy any imaginary part. This is still an admissible a kernel of my point process. So nice. This is the thing which is not specific to my model. Like this is always true for, you can always add a phase to a kernel of determinant type point process. So what is a determinant type point process? So the formal definition is if you look at the number, the expected value of the number of points which fall in disjoint sets, you can write it as the integral over, so this product of disjoint sets, of a determinant. This means that all the correlation functions are given by determinants filled in always in the same way, like rho k, so the kth correlation function is given by, you take your kernel k, you fill the matrix with the first entrance k x1, x1, k x1, x2, k x1, x3, and so on and so forth. I like to see it as a Gram matrix for k, if k was an inner product, then it would be the Gram matrix of the inner product. And then you take the determinant of this k by k matrix. So this is a very rigid structure. Like you really need to, all your correlation functions are given by determinants of matrices built in a very explicit way. The kernel determines the point process in distribution. Okay. If you believe me that the correlation function determines the point process, if you know k, you are able to compute the determinants, and then you're good. And the only property, there are plenty of properties which are super nice for determinant type point process. There is only one that I'm going to use here. So this is this one. If you have a sequence of determinant type point processes, you have a sequence of kernels. If the kernels converge, then the point process converge. In which sense? So I mentioned the definition of these three slides on the DPPs. Like the theorems are of course not mine. Some of them are older than me. So these are very classical results that I need to state. So just saying if you have a sequence of data multipoint process associated to a sequence of kernels, the notion of convergence you want on kernels is uniform convergence on compact sets. So if you are in an open set, on any compact subset, you need uniform convergence. So if you have this convergence towards the limiting k infinity, then there exists a data multipoint process chi infinity such that you have convergence in distribution. What is this convergence in distribution? This is the convergence in the sense of with convergence of Radon measures. So it's just something very basic. In any compact set, the convergence of the law of number of points in the compact. So it's a, like, it's a rather weak convergence of point process, but a very usual one. Okay, are we good with data point processes? Okay, to summarize, because this will be extremely important, because from now, I will only take care of the Bitcoin call two parts. So a DPP is characterized by a kernel. The kernel is explicit, given by this formula. And if I want to show convergence of a point process, or of a sequence of data multipoint processes, all I need to do is to show uniform convergence of kernels on compact subsets. And the last ingredient that I want you to keep in mind is that I have some freedom on my kernel, because I could add a complex phase if I want to my EV. Okay. So now it's time to give you some high. Okay, I need to define something which I'm going to call a nice measure. Because with what I defined, any background, so you could imagine something absolutely horrible, like you could take a set with order Hausdorff dimension, I don't know what, take a priority measure on this and form a Jellium. So this I don't want to study. I want to study something nice in terms of regularity. So an admissible measure will be what? More or less the drawing that you see. So it can be compactly supported, it can be not compactly supported. The support is the part in purple. So in this drawing, you have this. So you have like in the interior, in the exterior of the potato. Let me annotate. In the exterior part here, what I meant here is you have density with respect to the bag, which is extremely regular, like C infinity. In this part here, what you have is, you have in this part of the support, you allow density with respect to the bag, but also a density with respect to arc length measure on the curve. Okay, so you allow something singular on the boundary. And you also allow parts where you just charge a curve, like the circle that we saw before. So everything can be compactly supported, not compactly supported. I don't really care. But like this is the kind of measures that I allow. So very, and also all the boundaries of the domain that you can see, like all the curves that are drawn, must be real analytic. So something super smooth. Okay. So on the right, this is not a simulation, this is an illustration. Because it's very hard to simulate a Jellium or a Coulomb gas in general. So on the right, if I had started with the measure given by the purple areas, you would see many electrons given by black dots clustering on the measure. And it's not probably super clear on your screen, but these guys here are not black dots. Like this is a tiny white square. These are the outliers. So these are also electrons, but I represent them differently because they are not on the support of my background measure nu. Is it clear? So what I want to study is the white squares. Are we good? Hello? Ça va? Ah, j'ai un truc. Allô?
Yes. I hear you. At least me.
Okay. No, yes. I didn't show. Okay. For like 10 seconds, my computer froze. So, okay. So to be very clear, like what I want to study is I fix, for let's say omega 2. So the what is inside the curve, the what, so let me erase what I wrote. So what I my goal in this talk is to study what happens in this area, like in omega 2. Can I describe the outliers? Also in omega 1, can I describe the outliers? This is what I really want to do. Okay. So the result is can be stated in a very short way. So Xn is my jellium. So all the particles that you were described before. I look at omega, a simply connected component of the complement of the support. So okay, if I look at my drawing just before, omega 1 is not admissible here because it's not simply connected. It has two holes. There is omega 2, which is a hole, and this purple part. Omega 2 is simply connected. So this is the component I want to study in this theorem. What I'm saying here is that if I look at the outliers, so I forget all the other points and just look at the points in omega 2 here, as a point process, it converges in distribution towards the limiting point process, which is the Bergman point process on omega. So the Bergman point process on omega is a determinantal point process associated to the Bergman kernel of omega. Okay, what is the Bergman kernel of omega? It's a rather classical thing in potential theory or complex analysis, which is the kernel of the orthogonal projection from L2 to L2 and holomorphic. Okay, so L2 on omega only. And this kernel can be written explicitly if you take an orthonormal basis of L2, so functions phi k, which are L2 on omega and holomorphic on omega, you take an orthonormal basis of this space and you can write the Bergman kernel as the power series, not a power series, an infinite series. Okay, just mentioning in the radial case, a similar result was already obtained by me and David Gersasler. So, okay, one more drawing. So imagine that the blue part is the support of the measure. So here you would like to apply this theorem in U or in V. So the theorem tells you that if you look at the component here, the outliers in the limit will behave like the Bergman point process of U. You can also apply the theorem here and say, and get that the outliers will behave like the Bergman process of V. So first of all, I want you to notice that this limiting process only depends like in the way it was defined, the limiting process only depends on omega, the component considered. It does not depend on nu. So whatever, so if you fix the support of nu, you can change nu in the support however you want. The outliers won't feel it. So it's one surprising feature of the system. But okay, can I really describe, okay, can I describe what is this Bergman process of u? Because like, okay, I wrote an expression for the kernel, but it's probably like it's not super explicit. You need to find an orthogonal basis, and so it's probably not super explicit. So this is where conformal invariance kicks in. So if you take a conformal map from the unit disk to, for instance, U here, which exists because they are both simply connected, then, okay, the image by this conformal map of the Bergman process of the unit disk has the same distribution as the Bergman process of U. So it's like, so it doesn't really, okay, it depends on U, of course, but it depends on the set in a very nice way, because if you want to understand one set or another set, you just need to apply a conformal map to your process and you find the new process. So to make this process is a little bit less mysterious, what I need to tell you now is what is the Bergmann process of the unit disk. So the Bergmann process of unit disk has an explicit kernel, which is given by the formula that you see. BD is 1 over pi 1 minus ZW bar squared. And for instance, if you want to know the number of points which fall on average in a set A, all you have to do is to integrate the Bergmann process, the Bergmann kernel, on the diagonal over the set A. So the last formula. So this formula here tells you that if you want to know how many points there is like in the domain of the disk, then you integrate and you get this number of points. And if you want to know for a general set, just apply conformal map. One last thing about this formula. So the Bergmann point process has a finite number of points in any compact set. But the number of points on that explodes when you reach the boundary. So the correct image to have is really like you have some points inside, and when you get close to the boundary where there are charges, then the number of points explodes. So, okay, the easiest example that we could think of, the circle. So this is the same image as you saw before. I take new uniform on the circle. So the inside of the unit disk is a simply connected component of the complement of the support. What it tells me is that what I see inside is in the limit, the Bergmann problem process of the unit disk. Okay, so the crosses which are on the circle, actually they are not exactly on the circle, like half of them are inside the circle and are part of this Bergmann point process. Are we good with this first theorem?
I have a question, Rafael.
Yes.
Just in case I missed something, but there's no scaling, so it's just
there is no scaling. You just take the particles in the hole, okay, and they converge at the point process. Like this is really this picture. Like this is just a simulation without any scaling.
Okay.
Okay. But one remark. My notion of convergence is what happens in compact sets. Okay, so I cannot get what is arbitrarily close from the boundary. So my notion of convergence is fix a set and look at what is the distribution of how many points fall in this set. Okay, so what I cannot do is to zoom in at around the point like this. This I cannot do.
Yeah, one question, please. Rafael, do you hear me?
Oui. Yes.
You said that you are going to have infinitely many points near the boundary.
Yes.
But I wonder, what if your original measure, the distribution decays? Let's not think about a disk, but let's think about, let's say, some ball. And what if the density decays at the boundary?
Okay.
Will you still see an infinity
yes.
Boundary?
So actually, in the radial case, it was I proved with David Garcia that there is absolutely no regularity condition on the measure. It can decay like in the radial case, like here in this part, you could put a density which decays in the order that you like.
Mm-hmm.
Inside the disk, you would always see the same thing.
Okay.
But in the theorem that I stated, like in my good measures, from my good measures, ask the density with respect to Lebesgue. Like when it's not radial, I need to ask that the density is bounded from above and below, everywhere uniform.
Okay.
But okay, I really think that this is just a technical assumption because in the radial case, you really don't need it.
Okay, thank you.
So
I have one question too. Sorry.
Yes?
Actually, I was wondering what happens. I mean, how do you see the different scales? Of course, when you say that when you get close to the domain to the support of the measure, your point process will get you will have infinite points, and otherwise you have a finite remaining. But how do you see in the convergence in law the difference of the two regimes? Because if you took the two processes, the or if you look at the measure on your target set and the measure on the complement, You know that one is, I mean, singular with respect to the other one. So how do you see that in the when you take the limit?
There is a parameter
somewhere which is not.
So to do it very quickly. So if you know the time type point processes, you have this kernel Kn. Mm-hmm. What I will show is that Kn of ZW converges towards this Bergman kernel if we are on omega, so where there is no mass. Mm-hmm. The convergence of empirical measure gives you that 1 over n kn of zz, let's say, converges towards nu. Okay. Like when you are, when z is in the support, this is the scaling that that gives the convergence. Okay. There is like, if you put yourself at the edge, something very weird happens, that in what direction it converges without scaling, and in and in the inside direction you need to scale.
Right. Okay.
But okay, this I didn't do. Like I am only looking at this part. But if you really want to, this is why I said I cannot place myself there and look at the scaling limit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but this, like this, would be something very strange, but probably doable.
Okay.
Thank you. So I will give ideas of the proof later, but I want to, this one question that I want to study is, what about this exterior part? Because in the images that we saw, the exterior part is not simply connected, because the exterior part has a hole, which is a disk. Or in the other drawings, there were examples of like very natural domains that you can draw, which are not simply connected. Another example would be like, if you have something like this, you charge two circles in the middle, what happens? So imagine I'm charging this circle. So there is the inner disk is simply connected, it's fine. But in the middle, there's something I don't know, and like, I don't know this neither. So I really want to describe what happens when the domain is not simply connected. And there's something extremely strange which appears. So, okay, we take a nice measure, we take omega, so connected components of the complement of the support, so an uncharged region, and we assume that it is L connected, so it has L holes. Like when you are simply connected, you are zero connected. So one connected is one hole, two connected is two holes. And to be able to state the theorem, we need to fix points in each of the holes in omega, and to call Q1, QL the mu, the new charge, the charge of each of these components. And now we need to assume something very strange. You need to look at exponential 2i pi kappa n q1. And you need to assume that for each of the hole, this guy, so this exponential 2i pi kappa n q1 converges to some limiting point on the circle. Like this exponential 2i pi n1 is a point on the circle. It's moving, and you need to assume that it converges to somewhere on the circle. And you want this to converge for each of the holes. Then if along a subsequence this happens, then along this same subsequence, the point process in the hole, just the outliers in the hole, the point process in omega converge towards a limiting point process, which is the Bergman point process on omega associated to a weight. So, okay, the Bergman point process associated to the weight. So if you remember, the Bergman process was the kernel of the projection from L2 to L2 and holomorphic. Okay, the weighted Bergman process is the kernel of the projection from L2 with this weight onto L2 with this weight and holomorphic. So what is very sad is that the outlier process in general do not converge, because like there are several subsequences which converge to different points in the circle. So you could get, and you get in general, several subsequences going to several different Bergman processes. So in an annular region, for instance, there is no convergence. But at least we know all the possible limit of subsequences. And what I said, the limiting is just a kernel of the projection. So, okay, to apply this theorem, So I wanted to go through the theorem again with this drawing. So let's say we want to understand the outliers in omega one. What do we need? What are the parameters of this? So omega one is two connections. There are two holes in omega one. I lost my pen. Yeah, my pen here. This is hole number one, hole number two. So to apply the theorem, we need to consider Q1, which is the mass of this the mass of the first hole, and Q2, which is the mass just of the curve. And we need to fix two points, Z1 and Z2. Then if we assume that exponential 2i pi kappa n Q1 converges to 2i pi Q1, and same for the other guy, then you would get a limit. One last thing, okay, this theorem is a little bit harsh to get. The point zk play no role. I needed them, okay, I should erase what I wrote. I needed the zk's to define the weight. Here are the zk's. But the limiting, like by unicity of the limits, if I take another choice, like other choice for the zk's, then the two Bergman process of the limits must agree because like unicity of the limit. So like these zk are very artificial. The limiting, like the Bergman point process actually doesn't depend on the zk, it only really depends on the qk. Okay. So second example of the same of the same theorem. So as I said before, so here we already know that we have Bergman of the disk because this is simply connected. What is unclear is here and here. So for this region here, what will count, what will be important is the charge of the circle. If the like if exponential 2i pi kappa n times the charge of the circle converges to something, then the outliers in this region will converge. And for the exterior region, okay, let me erase. For the exterior region, what happens? For the exterior region, what will be useful is the mass of the hole. But the hole is like contains the whole support of the measure. So what will be important is exponential 2i pi kappa n times, okay, what is the new mass of the whole support? It's one. So one very important example, I think I'll probably do it next slide, is that if I take kappa n to be equal to n plus one, okay, integer, then this is always one. And so for kappa n equal n plus one, if you are in the exterior component, which has only one hole, then you converge towards the Bergman process. Okay, so let me erase this. Okay, so yeah, okay. Actually, I didn't remember if I wrote it. So quickly, for the inner disk, it's for free. For the middle annulus, you need to check the convergence. For the outside annulus, you need to check the convergence of exponential 2a by kappa n. But for the special choice, kappa n equal 8 plus 1, it's for free. And one very, very funny thing. So okay, we're going to play a game. It's not really a game, but we're going to play a game. For the annulus, we can compute the Bergman process with one parameter. So the parameter is Q, and I compute it like BZZ and BQZZ is the intensity of the point process. So I can plot this guy for different values of Q. We're going to try to look very closely. So this is for, so the goal is I will plot so the intensity of the point process for various Qs, and you need to tell me if you are able to distinguish anything between them. So for Q equals zero, you get this curve. Okay, next one. For Q equals 0.666, you get this curve. And for Q equals 0.9, you get this curve. So this is the intensity of the point process. I'm telling you, we know that the point processes are different. So okay, maybe we can go back. Actually, so okay. I will not let the suspense go much longer. Okay, you need to have insanely good eyes to be able to spot a difference. Because the, okay, these curves are different. And you can like look at the difference. You fix a point, you let parameter Q. So this curve is what? I fixed a point, like the point is 2/3, and I plot with respect to the parameter Q, what I get. So you get something periodic. And the magnitude of this is, okay, probably on your screen is too little to be seen, 10 to the minus 11. So what is very funny, and we have no true explanation for this, is that these curves, all the curves that you saw, which are the intensity of different point processes, they are different by, like they all live in a 10 to the minus 11 neighborhood of the first one. So like, okay. So if you want to do experiment, like numerical experiments to say, oh, like along different subsequences, I can see different point process, you need to have a very good computer. Because simulating one Coulomb gas is already a pain. So you need to simulate a bunch of them. Are we good with the statement of the theorem? Because now I will give some, okay. At what time should I stop?
You have 15 minutes.
15, okay, so more than good. So if there are some questions about the statement, because now I will explain a little bit how you can prove this kind of state of results. So if there are questions of the statement, I can take them now.
So why is that? Hi, Rafael, I have a question. Yes. If you take a region, which is not simply connected, but you can consider a simply connected subset of the region. Can we treat it like the first part of the statement?
No. Like I only allow myself to take a full connected component of the complement of the support.
Oh, okay.
So I have no right to just look at this. Like when I look, so what you're suggesting is I have my analysis. And could just say, oh, I want to look at what happens in a tiny ball. This is not allowed for my theorem. I take omega, which is a connected complement of the support. So here, for in this statement, there are 3, 1, 2, 3. And this is the only thing I can consider. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. So, how do you prove this kind of result? Okay, when I made as I said, we have determined type point processes. So there is a kernel KN which was explicit, which describes entirely the point process. And as I told you before, if I get uniform convergence of the kernel of compact subsets towards the limiting kernel, then I have convergence of point processes. So okay, what I didn't tell you, which was okay for you. Also an important ingredient is that the full Coulomb gas, the full Jellium is a point process, is a determinant point process. So if I restrict it to a region of the space, let's say omega, then it is also determinant point processes with kernel, which is just given by the restriction of the kernel. So if I want to show that the outliers in omega converge towards something, I just need to show uniform convergence of the kernels in omega. Like in omega times omega. Okay? So what I really want is uniform convergence of the kernels in compact sets of omega times omega. What I claim is that I have for free, okay. I will explain how to get it, but like you get like the okay. What I'm going to describe now is a reduction going from uniform convergence of kernel to something much simpler to obtain. Because in the literature of determinant point processes, it's usually kind of hard and sometimes very hard to get uniform convergence. So if you can relax it to like, let's say 0.5x convergence, it's much better. And what I'm claiming is that I have a bound which is for free. And this bound for free is Kn of ZZ is always smaller, whatever Z, whatever N, than the Bergman process of omega, the Bergman kernel in ZZ. Okay, this is only true in if omega is simply connected. If omega is not simply connected, there is some weighted guy which appears on the right, but I will only prove for simply connected. Okay. imagine that we can add a complex face. Okay, so Kn, if you remember what it was, Kn was, I can probably write it here. Kn of ZW was a sum from k equals 0 to n of some orthogonal polynomial pk of z, pk of w bar exponential minus kappa n v of z plus v of w. So, okay, I want to do some holomorphic tricks. These guys are polynomials. So they are holomorphic in z, and the other guy is anti-holomorphic in is holomorphic in w bar. But this guy has nothing to do with holomorphic. So, okay, what I'm saying is that I can add a complex face to V such that V suddenly becomes, so V plus its complex face is suddenly an holomorphic function. If I do this, then my kernel becomes an holomorphic function in Z and W bar. So this would be great. I'm going to explain how I do it, but if I can do it, then for free, Kn is an holomorphic function in Z and W bar. B omega, by a very standard result on Bergman kernels, is also an holomorphic function in each of its variables, Z and W bar. And because I have this bound, Kn of ZZ always smaller than B omega of ZZ, plus some, I need some also some extra estimates. I can use Montel theorem. Okay, Montel theorem in one complex variable is a theorem which says that if you have a family of holomorphic function which is bounded on compact sets, then it is pre-compact. So you have convergent subsequences, and if any subsequence has a convergent subsequence. So there is the Montel theorem for two variables, and I can apply it. So I know that my sequence of kernel Kn of Z and W, for any subsequence, I have a convergent subsequence. And the limit is holomorphic. So this is great, because all I need to do is to show that there is only one possible limit of subsequence. If I show that there is only one possible limit of subsequence, then I get for free the sequence converges. Also, when I say pre-compact, I mean pre-compact in the compact open topology. So when I say every subsequence has a converging subsequence, like every subsequence has a converging subsequence, and the convergence is uniform on any compact set. Like this is the topology that I'm looking at. Okay. So if I can get this bound, okay, what I want to convince you is that if I can get this bound and I can make Kn to be something holomorphic, then I can go from proving uniform convergence on compact subsets of omega times omega, which is potentially very hard, to just, what I need is to identify the limit. And I claim that it is enough to have pointwise convergence on the diagonal. So Kn of ZZ converging to B omega of ZZ for fixed Z, it's enough to identify the limit. So how do I get my holomorphic kernel? Actually, this is where the simply connected assumption kicks in. So if omega is simply connected, I remind you that V is a logarithmic potential of a probability measure. Outside of the, so V, okay, V nu, that is defined by Laplacian of V nu equals nu. So if I'm looking outside of the support of nu, this becomes, in omega, Laplacian of V nu equals zero, because nu is not supported in omega. So actually, my potential V nu is an harmonic function in omega. So by a very standard theorem of complex analysis, harmonic function on simply connected domains are the real part of an holomorphic function. So there exists a function V1, a complex phase, such that V0 is called V nu plus I V1 is an holomorphic function on omega. Okay? So now in my formula before, which was like Kn equals sum of polynomials Pk, Pk bar, now I add for free my complex phase, kappa n V0 plus V0 bar. Okay, now I need the complex conjugate because it is now a complex function. But now this is holomorphic. which is important. Let me erase it. How do I, the key inequality will come in one line. Okay. The Bergman kernel satisfies, okay. The Bergman kernel is the kernel of a projection operator. So I can write it as a supremum of function divided by n. So the Bergman kernel in ZZ is the supremum over all holomorphic functions in L2 of f of z squared divided by the integral over like the L2 norm, enfin, the L2 norm squared. The second inequality is, okay, trivial, but very interesting. I can say, oh, if I want to add a weight, like, so if rho is a non-vanishing holomorphic function, I can just say, oh, but the multiplication by rho is a bijection, is actually an isometry between L2 of omega and L2 of, actually should be, it's not a U, it's, oh, okay, there is a typos everywhere, every U is an omega here. So just saying that F maps to F rho is an isometry between L2 of omega and L2 of omega with right rho. And multiplying by a non-zero holomorphic function, I can also divide by a non-zero holomorphic function. So this is all I come back. So this supremum that I wrote is really just an equality because, yeah, you have an isometry and you can just identify the two guys. Oh, okay. I asked Avelio if, okay. So I'm sorry. Okay. This is unfortunate, but this is some French. You can easily show something very similar for your Kn, because okay, Kn is also a projection kernel. And you can also write it in a very similar shape. But the supremum is not over all L2 functions and holomorphic, just the supremum is taken over polynomials. So on the upper, it's like in this, in here, you want to take rho equal to exponential minus kappa n v0 of z, which is a non-vanishing holomorphic function. And you compare the two guys. What do you get? So the numerators are the same, but you take as the supremum is taken over a larger set, and you divide by something smaller. So you get really instantly, and also, okay, on this side, there are many typos. This is omega, and this is omega. Yeah, as you can see, while I was preparing this talk, I changed my mind several times between calling the region omega or u. So, and on some image that I made, I called them u, and some other I called them omega. So, this is how you get for free the super important bound. And okay, this bound is really of capital importance because this what allows you to get Montel and everything. Let me erase. Okay, one word, like, so we saw that the reason why simply connected is nicer is because harmonic functions are the real part of a non-homomorphic function. What happens, what is the same theorem when you are not simply connected? When you are not simply connected, it's not true that any harmonic function is the real part of a holomorphic function. There is a reminder. You need to add something. And this something to add is this guy. Okay. If you want to be the real part of a holomorphic function, you need to add something. And this is what will give rise. So if I look at exponential this guy, I will get, like, if I want so to introduce this V0, I will get weight which appears for free. So I won't say, I don't want to say anything more about this non-simply connected case, just saying that this weight appears not magically, it only comes from the fact that you really want to deal with holomorphic functions, and so you need to complement them. And okay, if you do this, you will get an inequality, which is the same. Okay, so let me end the proof. Actually, the proof is not super long. Okay, all we need to show is that. Okay, all we need to, well, okay, this is probably a little bit heavy. All I want, okay, I know that Kn of ZZ is smaller than B omega of ZZ. This is for free. I want the converse inequality. I want that B omega of ZZ is less or equal than the lim inf of Kn of ZZ. This is all I need to finish the proof. Okay, it's really written awfully. So, and I'm adding some extra information and say I'm reminding you that the Bergman kernel can be written using an orthonormal basis. Whatever orthonormal basis of L2 made of holomorphic function, I can write this. And I remind you that my kernel was written in this way. Okay, so how I do now? All I want is a pointwise convergence. So all I want is a lower bound. What I can do for free is, okay, this the left sum is an infinite sum. To get a lower bound, I can bound it from below by just the first big K terms. So all I need is actually to control the first terms in Kn in this sum, the first, I don't know how many terms, and to show that they converge towards an orthonormal system in L2. Okay? And this will give me for free instantly the lower bound. If nu is radial, this is actually an exercise that you could give to students because, okay, what do you do? You take, when you have radial weights and your domain is also instantly radial, your psi k are just like monomials, ck times z to the k, and your pkn are what? Are just not constant ckn times zk. So all you need to do is to compute the ckn and show that they converge. So it's rather easy. When nu is radial, this is what I'm going to tell you. So, okay, there is a procedure. Oh, I'm getting out of time. Okay, so I'm just saying
yes, quickly. Like 2 minutes, let's say.
Okay, 2 minutes will be enough. So quickly, there is a procedure to, okay, what we want is to build an ortho, we fix any orthonormal system, and we want to build an adapted polynomial basis. And to do this, okay, we start, so what we want is this convergence, and okay, there is a procedure, okay, I was probably too optimistic. There is a procedure to say, okay, these guys, I want to extend them over the whole plane, these are not polynomials, but at least they are getting close. Like I start from the right-hand side, which is undefined on omega. I extend it over the whole plane, and I want to turn it into polynomials. There is something which I call D-bar magic, which is Raumander theorem, which is okay. It's a procedure in complex analysis. Like it's a very weird but powerful theorem. Like you can see it. Like if you want to, like my mental image is like it's as surprising as Anbanach. Like you can do things which are as like which look as which are as close as dark magic as what you can do with Anbanach. And you can okay, you can do this approximation procedure. Okay. Okay, one last thing I wanted to mention because I spent maybe 5 minutes talking about random polynomials. I show you pictures about random polynomials and then I forgot them totally. Because actually everything we did applies to random polynomials too. And why? Okay, so all the theorems you saw before are true, but under the hypothesis, which is purely technical, that the measure should be supported also only on curves. And okay, so this slide very quickly says that zeros of random polynomial are not a determinant type process. So there is no kernel, but there is something else. It's a Gaussian field with correlation kernel. And this correlation kernel looks a little bit like the kernel of a DPP. We can play with it in the same fashion. Like we have the right to multiply, actually we have the right to multiply by any non-vanishing function. So this is like, we have even more room to play. And to show the same result for random polynomials, what we need to show is that the kernel multiplied by a good function converges uniformly on compact subsets towards the limiting kernel. And so limiting kernel should be the Zego kernel. Okay, so it's a kernel which is well known to analysts, or well known to some analysts. And all you need is to do more or less the same thing. So you multiply by the good weight and you want to show up, you get some similar equality and the same arguments lead to the same kind of result. So the take home message is I spent a lot of time explaining how it works for the Jellium because I think the model that interests most people. For random polynomials, you can do the same, except that we have very strong limitation on the new that we can take because we only manage to prove it for new supported on curves. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Rafael. So before the questions, I propose that we unmute ourselves and thank our speaker. But it was funny because I muted myself when I said that. I unmuted two times. So are there any questions apart from the ones? So let me start and then you can. So in fact, how do you simulate these processes? It's a really simulation type of question, but I was always wondering with the pictures you had, the random polynomial seems easy, but
this is actually a random polynomial picture. For random polynomials, you take radial weights, you compute the orthogonal polynomials, and then you ask the Mathematica to solve polynomial equal zero.
Yes.
For Coulomb gases, there is a reason why this is just an illustration and not a simulation. There are algorithms to compute, like there is one by Shafai and Ferre, where there is a diffusion. Okay, you have your Hamiltonian, you could look at Langevin dynamics, and so you get a DS in a
stochastic differential equation.
Yes, with invariant law given by the distribution of the Coulomb gas. So if you run this stochastic equation long enough, then you're close to the distribution that you want. And this is how, for instance, this image was done.
Okay, so you can manage so many points, that is also.
Yeah, okay. Okay, this technique works for any beta. For beta equals two, there are techniques using the determinant structure to simulate stuff. But I never use them. I just took the software developed by Shafai and Ferre, plugged in my parameters, and obtained my pictures.
And they work for any mu, let's say.
Their procedure is very strong because it works, I think, in any dimension, any temperature, any V. It's something very general for when you have a Gibbs measure, the distribution of my Coulomb gas is a Gibbs measure, associated to the Hamiltonian, you can look at Langevin dynamics. And if things are not too ugly, then it could converge towards the distribution of your Coulomb gas.
Yes. So I had another question, which was less practical, but what happens if you add some protons in your story? So let's say that a certain part of a helium can move, like of the positive charges. Will they appear as in the outlier portion, or?
So you like to do something mixed, like some parts fixed and to allow some protons to move, right?
Yeah, let's say it is less than, because you don't want them to be of order n. Let's say that you have a square root n protons, or let's say that you have 10 protons. Let's say you have 10 protons. Are you going to see them in the inside of your?
Actually, this I never thought about. So you could get, so you could add an extra term, but what I wonder is like, would it probably kill the determinant structure of your process?
Ah, yes.
So like it could be, okay, yeah. One thing I can say is that when you are not at beta equal two, I don't know how to do anything. Like this determinant structure is the only thing that allows me to study stuff. So, yeah, so I don't really have an insight of your, on your process. I know that you like this two-body, long glasses, but that's okay. Yes.
Thank you. So are there any other questions?
Yeah,
Well, I was just going to ask about the simulation, but Abelio just did. What about dimension three? Can one expect anything?
Okay, so my mental image is the following. Imagine that you have your circle of, let's do it on another guy, on this guy, on the disk. My mental image is the following. You have this background, and you have your electrons going on the background. They neutralize the system. So if you have an electron living here, what do you see? You see the positive charges attracting you, and you see all the other electrons, okay, all the electrons except a proportion which is really negligible, like let's say there are square root n electrons outside. So nearly all of them repelling you in exactly the same way. So there is something called screening, and the guy here doesn't see the specifics of new. This could, like, this image is also meaningful in dimension three. You could look at a gelium in dimension three and say, like, if I am all outside of the support, I could, like, I should not see the other guys. But dimension three, dimension two are something very different, is the type of the interaction. In dimension two, your interaction is log, so it has very long range. Or in dimension three, the Coulomb interaction is 1/z. So the range is much shorter and probably something, okay. Just saying, I imagine that something similar could happen, but like dimension three and higher are usually kind of different to dimension two because the interaction is very short range. So I have mixed feelings, let's say.
Thank you.
Okay, my question is, well, in the case of, let's say the Coulomb gas, you have some logarithmic interaction potential associated and a confinement potential. Okay, that you can relate to the kernel in the determinantal process. So, and my question is, can you see your determinantal process, the Bergman process, in terms of some potential? I mean, interaction potential, or I mean, is it explicit, or can you?
As a kernel.
Yeah, the kernel. The kernel. Can you relate it to some interaction between between the particles, or some?
Try to go as where I wrote the. So you like to see the log interaction. Okay, I try to find where, okay, this. So you like to see the log interaction in the kernel, right?
I don't know if a log interaction, but in some kind of interaction between the particles, the pairs of, I don't know if pairs, but if can you relate it to some potential, the point process?
Okay, I'm not sure to understand, like, this, okay, for me, like, this part, the fact that you have, like, some orthogonal polynomials, mm-hmm, is really, mm-hmm, something specific to this log interaction.
Yes.
This is really something which is, okay, one way of seeing it is that I wrote before this product of xi minus xj to the beta,
like, okay,
okay, in beta equals 2, like, this, mm-hmm, is really a Van der Mond determinant.
Yes, yes.
And, okay. The Van der Mond determinant is a determinant of the evaluation of polynomials.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like if you take fixed endpoints and consider the morphism, like
yeah,
the, mm-hmm, polynomial evaluated to n different points, this is how you get, like, this is really the reason why you go from, this is why you get this,
yeah,
projection, mm-hmm, operator on polynomials.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But but I'm not sure to understand the potential part of your question.
No, because okay, you have some interaction, you have some pair potential in the Coulomb gas.
Yes.
And then when you take the limit for this case or well, in the setting that you were speaking about, it wasn't exactly this, but you can identify you can associate to the point process, you can associate an interaction potential. So in this is before taking the limit, but then when you take the limit to your kernels in the limit, can you interpret that in terms of some interaction between the points? That's my question.
No, like, do you have an example? Like for instance, for Ginevra, like,
may I say something? I think I, yes, can answer Hawkins. Mm-hmm. So in the limit, what happens is that what you see, I mean, the pair interaction, or the way you want to call it, it's hidden in the fact that it's a determinantal process.
Ah, mm-hmm. Yes, the two-point correlation function.
if you want, like the point is that the this log correlation, which becomes the van der Mond, it's what then you rewrite it as a certain you use these orthogonal polynomials, and then in the limit you have a determinantal point process which with some correlation, but the interaction is through the determinant through the fact that it's a determinantal point process, which actually comes from the fact that you had this log correlation with beta equals 2, which leads to the van der Mond determinant. So it's sort of all mixed up in there. I think that's the answer.
Yeah, there is no clear log that appears in the very end. Like,
okay.
But that's because it's lost in the limit. Yes. It's hidden inside the determinant somehow.
Okay, that's what.
Yeah, because like, for instance, in the Bergmann point process, the image that you have some points, like they should interact like, as log, like there are still electrons. Like the outliers that you see, like if you just look at two of them, like the like there should be somewhere hidden the interaction energy log. But it's not super clear how to relate it to the Bergmann kernel. Like for instance, if you take if you take this guy and this guy, they should interact with log. It's like hidden in the process.
Yeah, my question was rather, can you say that they interact with something through something, maybe not log, but but it's not clear in any case. It's not, it's hidden in the
But there are maybe like some formal, like I'm not an expert of this, but like the problem is like you have some infinite point process. Maybe you can, like, I know that some people worked on DLR equations to describe the interaction of points and some, like I know in dimension one, people did that to be able to compare the infinite point, the limiting process sin beta with some finite n stuff. So I know that there are some formalism, but I really am not an expert of this. And like,
and then dimension one, with what is what?
So in dimension one, there is a paper like we of Paul Jung, David Jael Shafai, and David Garcia, I think. Okay, in dimension one, the JM is a little bit weird because there is no universal. There are outliers. Mm-hmm. They look like Coulomb gas, like the true Coulomb gas in dimension one. So not the log gas. Coulomb gas in dimension one, and they saw there are outliers, but they are not. But they are not universal.
For the log gas, when you have the...
For the log gas in dimension one, I don't know. And actually, it's much harder. Because in dimension one, if you want to have asymptotics of the kernel of the DPP, it's like a Riemann-Hilbert stuff, and it's it's hard. I have no intuition to if it should... if there should be something interesting here.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a short question.
Yes, perfect.
I think it's short. So for different values of beta, if you change beta, do you know if it's expected that you would see the same thing? Looked at this or?
So nothing is expected. My conjecture is that there exists a process which describes the outlier. It must depend on beta. So there should be a Bergmann beta point process. And I hope that there is still this conformal equivariance, like conformal invariance of, but there is nothing done for general beta. And I really would like to do it.
Yeah, but I mean, by analogy with random matrices.
But for random matrices, if you look at non-Hermitian models, so you get things like Gini, but for general beta, not much is done. Like it's super hard when it's in dimension two.
No, but it's true that the point process depends on beta. So here it should
be. The point process, like you can do an heuristic argument, for example, the maximum, the tail of the maximum of the Bergmann point process decays like 1 over z to the 4. And if you look at the tail of the maximum for beta equals 2, it's 1 over z to, like 1 over z to beta.
Yeah.
And so when you are at beta equals 1, for instance, your maximum of your Coulomb gas is like 1 over z squared in tail.
Makes sense.
It cannot match. Like the tail depends on beta.
So you just a short for this question, you don't have a proof of the conformal invariance of the process. You just compute and it happens to be conformal invariant in a way.
No. Here I have a proof of the conformal invariance of the
process. But I mean it's because you compute what is the
it's just a classical relation, right? Because the Bergmann kernels are conformal invariant.
Yeah, but this is the proof to prove conformal invariance. It's not that you previously prove it's conformal invariant and then you do it on the circle.
No.
So this would be necessary for beta equals for different beta. You at least would want conformal invariance. Yes.
But okay, for general beta, I'm looking at a way to approach the problem. It's really not clear. And I had one hope, I think probably Joaquin could tell me this insight on this, but I wanted to use a Langevin dynamics. Because, okay, one of the very rare things which is valid for all beta is Langevin dynamics. So you could look at the stochastic differential equation of with n particles, let it evolve and it should converge to your gas. If you can get some estimate, for instance, for the number of particles in some large disk or outside the large disk, then you could try to have this estimate go n to infinity and see if it converges to something. This is one, this is the only approach I can think of, which is beta independent, and which does not rely on the temporal structure.
Yeah, it's kind of a similar way of formulating the question of how do you recover this process? I mean, when I asked about the possible interactions that could be underlying when you look at the process, I was thinking of the dynamics in at the end. I mean, what do you, if you start really with your particles in the way that you simulate them, for instance, well, what, how do you distillate, so to say, what you see in the range that you're interested in outside the support of the measure? So that, yeah, that's something I wouldn't know either in from the dynamic point of view. I mean,
but actually, your article with Jael Shafai and there was another author, this is the only article that gave me hope. You can do something with stochastic equations with Coulomb gases, and so I hope to try to do something. But,
yeah, the point is that you need to manage the two limits in time and then in order to and it's not. I mean, it's not that. It's not that clear. It's not clear how to do that. It's not. You don't have convexity like in the one-dimensional case where you know for the convergence to the semicircle law. And I mean, you can prove that you can have convergence in long time uniformly in n, and then you can see how you get the convergence to the semicircle with n goes to infinity for t equal infinity, let's say. In a way. And here it's not, we don't know how to do it. It's part of the question, actually. I mean, to control what happens outside of the support, it's part of the question, because you have a process which has support on the whole plane, and then suddenly you get at the end you get something which is in a compact set. So there is something, the singularity arises in a way that we don't understand very well. But yeah, so it's. It's ongoing, let's say. we haven't thought of that for a time, but next time we meet with Jalil, we should take this discuss about these questions again at some point.
Good. Thank you. So I propose we thank the speaker again. And we can stop the formal part of the